Good morning and welcome to Leverington Church. We're so glad you're with us for worship. We believe that keeping the Sabbath and worshiping God is a crucial habit to hold on to during these uncertain times. So please join us now for our first song as we sing out loud our praises to God.
Is to bring you praise. Good morning. My name is Rachel Cupp. I'm so glad that you are with us. Will you please pray with me? God, we have come here because we love you. You are great and good and true and just and merciful. You alone are God. We are amazed by who you are and what you have done and what you are doing. In this silence, we take a moment to praise you for who you are and to thank you for the specific things we are personally grateful for. Lord, we also have come here to be honest with you, to return to you, to confess to you the things we've done wrong this week, including the good things we failed to do. We think of our actions and the thoughts we've carried around that are not pleasing to you. In this silence, we repent of these things as we name them to you now. Father, you have told us that we can come to you like little children come to their parents and ask you for the desires of our hearts. You know the hopes, the worries, the fears, the desires we brought with us into this space. And so we ask you to intercede, to act, in the particular areas we name now in the silence of our hearts. Finally, Jesus, we want to give you our whole lives, not just part of it, but all of it. We yield our hopes, our dreams, our future, our decisions, our behavior, all that we are to you. We want your will to be done in our lives, so we yield everything to you now. Amen.
Stop. While it is natural for us to focus on our own situation and the practical concerns of the day in a time like this, it is exactly in such times that we need to pull the camera back and lift our eyes up to the big picture, the big story of who God is and what he has done and what he is doing and what is still true, even if the clouds, for a moment, have hidden the sun. So what is that big story? What are the essential truths of the Christian faith that all denominations and non-denominational churches agree to? What are the statements that Christians around the world, regardless of culture or color of skin or location, all agree are the essential truths that we are basing our lives and our decisions upon? There is probably no more concise statement of the Christian faith than the Apostles' Creed. And it is exactly in times like this, in times of uncertainty, that we need to stand up and to declare, not only to the world, but to ourselves, the truth of the gospel. So if you're willing, please join me as I join brothers and sisters around the globe today in declaring the truths that stand for all time. And as we say the Apostles' Creed, let's not say it by rote, let's say it from the heart as our own creed, saying, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Can we pray for you? Do you want your church family to surround you in prayer? If so, just click on the icon on our website. And also, if you'd like to be a prayer warrior on the front lines with our prayer team, also contact us at office@levpress.org. This morning, we have a few announcements. First, we all miss our church family dearly, and we didn't want to wait till our full in-person church service was up and running to be able to see and check in with our church friends. So, here's what we are doing. Every Sunday, starting next Sunday until October 18th, we will be meeting at the church just to hang out together, to check in on each other's lives and have casual conversation. There's no program. Just bring a mask, a chair, and your favorite coffee, and come be with us for a while. There's no need to sign up. Just stop by any time between 11 a.m. and 12 p.m. on any Sunday you can make it. You can see exactly what is happening on any given Sunday by going to our website and clicking on Sunday Morning Friends. I hope you can join us next Sunday. And today we want to give thanks to God for the lives of friends in our Leverington family who are having birthdays in this coming week. Hey, and if we don't have the date of your birthday, let us know at the email shown. So, happy birthday, Vera, Benjamin, Rodman, and Edith. May God bless you richly in the year ahead. And we want to remind you that Next weekend, we are doing our soup kitchen in the Frankfurt area of the city. This is a great way to help our fellow Philadelphians. And so if you want to be part of that, either making meals on Friday or serving them on Saturday, please go to our website and sign up now. And finally, we've been trying to think of ways to see more of your little faces on Sunday morning online worship services. So here's one way we're going to do it. We are going to get a bunch of folks to sing the doxology together and then use that to lead the rest of us in worship online. Now look, you don't have to have a great voice. You don't need to be a professional. You just need to like to sing. And there will be lots of people singing alongside you, so your voice isn't going to stand out. We want you to be part of this. So to participate, just email us at office@levpress.org and we'll get you all the information on how you can be part of this fun project. And as we move forward together in worship today, we're now going to take our offering. In these trying times, our church remains strong exactly because so many of you have been so faithful in supporting this community financially. Thank you to all of you who have stuck with us through thick and thin. And if you're not a regular giver, but you would like to help keep this ministry on the air, you can make a one-time donation right now by going to the website shown. Together, we are building the future of our church, and we believe that God has great things in store for us in the months ahead.
Thank you.
Well, it is good to be with you again as we continue our sermon series, Six Reasons to Hope, How to Flourish in Uncertain Times. And today we're in session three, Sunlight Coffee and Brown-Eyed Susans. Let's just go back to what we've looked at so far. First, we said that there's actually two kinds of hope. There's a big H hope and a little H hope. Big H hope is the hope that comes from the big story of the cosmos, that there really is a maker of heaven and earth, God, and that he broke into this world as Jesus Christ. And because of what he has done, because of what he's doing right now, and because of what he will do, we can have eternal hope, hope in the big, big story that ends well. But we also said there's a little H hope, that practical everyday hope that we need just to kind of get through every day, and that the big H hope and the little H hope kind of work together so that when I get that big H hope in my life, and we're going to really look at that next week, that can help me see hope in the everyday life. And in the same way, when I have hope in my everyday practical life, that gives me time and the ability and the openness to what that big H hope might be like. And conversely, when I don't have that big H hope, it can be hard for me to see hope in the everyday life. And also, and this is why we started with practical hope last week, when I don't have that everyday practical hope, when I'm like a starving man, I'm not that interested in hearing about the big metaphysics of life. I just want to feel better. And so we started with how to build practical hope in our life every day. And this very practical hope comes from choosing to live a particular way. Here's what Gwynne and Hellman wrote. Hope is the idea that you have goals you desire to achieve, you can identify pathways towards those goals, and you can direct and sustain your willpower toward the goal and pathways necessary to reach those goals. This simple yet powerful trilogy, now confirmed in hundreds of published studies, has become the science of hope. So having dreams or a goal isn't enough. You also need pathways, steps to achieve that goal. But even a plan isn't enough. You also need the willpower to kind of get off your butt and actually do it. And each of those by themselves isn't that much, but those three together begin to help you make a better future. Now, it might be a radically better future, or it might be just a little bit better. So maybe all it is something as small as, I'm just going to clean this countertop today. But what we find is if we create even a slightly better future, when we take these baby steps, then we start to feel more energy and start to get this willingness to take bigger steps. So what was my big goal for last week? I got a haircut. And so I want to thank Frank from Hairco on Ridge Avenue, just down the street from church, for giving me my first haircut since February. In fact, I came in the shop and Frank took one look at me and he said, wait 1 minute. I need to get my other scissors. Wait. I think we have a picture of it. So thank you, Frank, for my haircut. And it really is true. Taking little steps, even like that, we find ourselves a little more empowered, encouraged, and then we start focusing on other aspects of working to a slightly better future. And then what happens is hope sneaks in the back door. Like, we're just doing our thing, and all of a sudden we notice, hey, I'm in a better place. I feel better. And I think this kind of hope, this proactive hope, is what most of us need to focus on most. However, there's another kind of practical hope. It's not so much me acting upon the world as me seeing what's already in the world. It's not so much me making it happen as me seeing what's already happening. To have the eyes to see the good and the true and the beautiful. And those could be really big things, cosmic size things, or it could be really simple, basic things like brown-eyed Susans. So let's start first by looking at the big picture. Psalm 8 begins this way. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? Yet you have crowned him with glory and honor. The psalmist is taking a moment to stop from his work and stop from his worries and to look up and literally consider the big picture. He considers the wonders and the vastness of the universe. And notice how intimate his relationship with God is and how intimate God's relationship is with the creation. It's the work of his fingers. You see, even way back 4,000 years ago, men got that they were an insignificant speck in the cosmos. This isn't anything new. And yet God is mindful of us. And he didn't just make us, he crowned us with glory and honor. Hear how intimate that is. Imagine God placing a crown of glory and honor on your head. God originally made everything good. And even though human sin has made the world corrupt and bent and broken, and even though human hearts are now corrupt and bent and broken, there is still much goodness that remains in the world around you and in the people around you. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, a philosopher also takes time to consider the big picture of what God has done. And he concludes this in chapter 3, starting in verse 11. God has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the hearts of men, yet they cannot fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better. Nothing better for men than to be happy and do good while they live. That everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all his toil. This is a gift from God. In other words, there is real beauty to be found in this world because God put it there. And we find we have this yearning in our hearts, a sense that there's something more to life than we can see, but we can't quite see it. We can't quite grasp the big plan of God. But it is a gift from God that in the middle of our uncertainty, we can be happy and do good. Of course, not every moment, but time to time we can. And it is a gift from God when you enjoy a good meal or take satisfaction from your work. And so these things aren't just fleeting emotions. They are real gifts in the moment from God himself. Jesus tells us to consider the good things of the world, even things as fleeting and apparently insignificant as flowers. In Matthew, he says, consider. Consider how the lilies grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? It's God's idea to dress lilies in beauty and cause us to delight in them. And notice again that word, consider. It means to take the time to contemplate, focus on, think about, marvel in. So how often this week did you consider the moon and the stars and the clouds and the sky and the heavens? And how often did you consider the small things like the lilies of the field and what a cup of good coffee tastes like and sunlight on an old brick wall and the brown-eyed Susans at your feet? See, Jesus pays attention to these things. He pays attention to the lilies and clothes and really good tasting wine. And he enjoys all those things, and he calls us to do that as well. But he has this incredible balance in his teaching, because in the very next verse he says, "But do not set your heart on what you will eat or drink. Do not worry about it. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Consider the good things of the world, but don't set your mind on them." What does he mean? What's the difference? Well, to consider is to notice, to enjoy, to appreciate, to celebrate these things as signposts of the goodness of God and the goodness of this life he has given us. But they are not the thing itself. When we no longer see them as signposts, but rather as the thing itself, we turn them into idols. We conclude that real hope and happiness is found in them. And so we think, hey, if a few flowers or a really nice appetizer or a nice glass of wine made me feel happy, then lots of flowers or lots of food or lots of wine is going to make me feel really happy. Man, how many times do we have to relearn that that is not the way the world works? How many times do we have to go down that dead-end road before we learn that real happiness is not found in those things? Some of us never find out. We humans, we live in one extreme or the other. Either we ignore and pay no attention to all the good gifts around us in the world, and so despise the good gifts God has given us, and in a way despise the good giver, God. Or we go to the exact opposite extreme and we indulge in these things as if they're the source of our happiness. And when we treat them like that, we make them an idol. And so we walk away from God. But you know, it makes sense that at a time like this, in a pandemic, we might be tempted to overindulge. Because we feel so out of control, so unsettled, so out of sorts. We just want to feel better. We just want some soothing. And so we are tempted to try and soothe ourselves with the things of this world. And then we overindulge in them. We do it because we want to feel good all the time. We want a settled, permanent happiness. But as C.S. Lewis writes, the settled happiness and security, which we all desire, God withholds from us by the very nature of the world. But joy, pleasure, and merriment he has scattered broadcast like wildflowers. Our Father refreshes us on the journey with some pleasant inns, but will not encourage us to mistake them for home. No, we need to look at the good things of this earth not as solutions in and of themselves, but as delightful signposts pointing us towards home, love letters from God. Because too much of a good thing is not good. Even too much health food is not a good thing. But when we demote those things to their proper place, when used in the right proportion, they become a bright spot in a dark world, a pleasant inn along the road towards home. But often that road looks very dark indeed. As a matter of fact, just this week, a good friend of mine sent me a partial list of all the things that we're struggling with as a nation right now. Here's what he sent. Now, these are all serious. They are real. And notice, Jesus doesn't think life is all lilies and flowers and wine parties. He says today has enough trouble. In other words, he's acknowledging that the real world is full of troubles and heartache and suffering. In fact, if anyone knew deep sorrow and deep suffering, Jesus did. But when you worry about tomorrow, you're actually asking troubles to be bigger than they are, giving them more space and more time than they deserve. It's as if you're giving them a pay raise, letting them fill up your whole vision, blinding you to those little spots of goodness and beauty that are all around you, if only you had eyes to see. Do you have eyes to see? See what? Well, it really matters what you choose to notice. There's lots of things you could see, but it really matters what you choose to focus on, what you consider. So consider this image of this flower that we're using in this sermon series. So when you look at that, what do you notice? Here are two possibilities. You might say, oh, what a beautiful sign of hope, this fragile flower, new life, growing against all odds. Or you might notice something different. You might say, somebody really needs to fix the cracks in that road and kill the weeds. You know, if they don't fix it, freeze and thaw will make it worse every year, and then someone will trip and fall and die. Oh, yes, yes, pretty flower. But really, everything in the world is broken, and flowers don't last, and soon everything is going to die and rot. Well, yes, flowers don't last. But goodness and beauty do. They just take different forms over time. Even after the flower fades, there's an incredible hope and beauty for those who have eyes to see. Is not the dead flower still beautiful in its own way? Are these not a sign of seeds of the future, that there will be another spring? No, no, we can't get back what we have lost. No, we cannot get back what we miss so much, those things that lie behind us in the past. But there is the promise of a future spring locked up, waiting, waiting in those brittle, dry seeds. But all we see is our problems. We compare our lot to some utopia where everything is as it should be. But consider reality. Jay Desco writes, there are few people who have perfect mental health, perfect physical health, perfect marriages, perfect relationships, and wealth all at the same time. But all of us do have something good to see and to celebrate. Perhaps your business is struggling in the midst of the pandemic, but you made payroll again, and you have some great people on your team. Or maybe you are battling cancer, but you at least have the finances to cover your medical expenses. You get the picture. If you search for the good, it will always be there. And it is really important to develop the skill of seeing it. And it is a skill. It can require effort. When everything around you seems to be falling apart, the good things may be few and far apart. But they are there. And as we'll see, it's a serious business, a required skill to see them if we want to be truly hopeful. So when I think about the big things that I'm grateful for, like my family and my friends, or I think about the small things I'm grateful for, like sunlight and coffee and brown-eyed Susans, who am I grateful to? Is it to Mother Nature? Is it grateful to life? Is it grateful to random chance? I don't think so, because I know those things don't know how to give good gifts, and I don't really have a reciprocal relationship with them. So who am I to be grateful towards? The book of James tells us. James 1:17 says this, "Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights." In other words, every good gift comes from God. And you might say, yeah, but are you just ignoring all the bad? Are you ignoring all the darkness in this world and just pretending it's just this good stuff? Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2 says this, "On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. They rejoice before you, God, as people rejoice at the harvest." Now, this doesn't mean that suddenly all the bad things in the land have gone away. Not at all. They're all still there. But what it means is now there's a tiny light in the middle of that darkness. There's a light that wasn't there before. And that one small light, surrounded still by all that darkness, can be the difference between hopeless and hope. I can curse the darkness, or I can notice that one place where there's a spot of light. Will I despair over how much of the world is in darkness, or will I rejoice in the spots where there is light? And this is not just a matter of being an optimist over being a pessimist. It's the ability to recognize signposts. Signposts that are real, signposts that are there, signposts that point the way to the truth. The truth that is deeper than, bigger than, longer lasting than this present darkness. That there is a light that will never go out. Our final destiny is the land of light, because the one who is the light came into this dark world looking for us, looking for you. John 1:5 says this about Jesus, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not mastered it." Now that word "mastered" in the Greek has two different meanings. One is to master a topic, to understand something. And so the darkness has not understood the light. It has not fathomed the ways of God. But it also means master in to rule. So the darkness has not ruled or overcome the light, because this light will never go out. And so both of those meanings really do apply to Jesus. Jesus is this light that has come into the world, will never go out, and his light is a prelude and a promise of the things to come. Well, this understanding of the light and the darkness and the darkness not mastering the light, I think even applies to the simple good things. The things like sunlight at the end of the day, or good coffee in the morning, or brown-eyed Susans at your feet. Because I think when I develop the ability to notice and search out and appreciate the simple good things of life, that I'm also able to rightly understand the darkness as well. Here's what I mean. When you come to really appreciate the goodness of the good and the true and the beautiful, and to really value it, then you also value its loss. You know the weight of its loss because you know the weight of the goodness that was there. So you know, you have a sense of how much is lost when the good thing is taken away. But when you don't have that, when all you see is the darkness, you know, in my life, in times of deep grief or deep despair, the way I experience life is that it is flat. It's gray. Nothing tastes. The ordinary activities that used to give me joy, they seem pointless. And so both the good and the bad, it all just seems flat. And so I know, even in the midst of it, therefore, that I'm not seeing it accurately because they're not the same. They're very much different, the dark and the light. But when I'm not in a good place and I'm focused on the dark, I see neither the darkness nor the light correctly. And yet when I see the goodness and truth and I focus on them, I see both the goodness and the darkness correctly. So, if that's true, that's why it's so important to focus on the good, even if it's few and far between, even if 90% of what you're seeing is dark. It's not being a fool, it's not being naive to focus on the good, it's being wise. Are you wise? Do you consider the lilies of the field? So, how do we do that? How do we develop this habit? How do we have eyes to see? Well, in a very famous verse that many of you know, in Philippians chapter 4, it says this: "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about," or in other translations, "dwell on," or "consider such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you." So we're to think about, dwell on, consider such things. And we're to put this into practice. We're to practice focusing on the good and the beautiful and the noble things. Now, certainly, that starts with exposing myself to the Word of God and the Scriptures, but also music and art and good books and sunlight and coffee and brown-eyed Susans. It takes effort to fight that natural drift towards unhealthy things. You know, the things that marketers and politicians and media companies are constantly putting in front of our face, laying down right in front of us like a plate of slop. But the truth is that garbage in equals garbage out. You think about it, when you eat good things and healthy things instead of garbage, it makes your body feel better. Well, when you feed your mind and your heart and your soul with good things, it makes your heart and your soul feel better. It builds hope in your life. Okay, well, what's a good example? Let me give you one really practical example of this kind of thing. The Philadelphia Art Museum is back open. What if I were to make the effort to just take a visit there, to intentionally consider good and beautiful and true things? So you see, something as small and fragile as a brown-eyed Susan can be a signpost to me, a breadcrumb, a love note pointing me to a loving Heavenly Father, pointing me to the end of the story, reminding me that this story ends well. But meanwhile, the darkness, it points to nothing but itself. Just changing the diet of what I'm looking at and thinking about, what I really spend my time considering, can change my sense of hope, moving me from hopeless to hopeful. So what do you spend most of your time considering? If you're really honest, what do you really spend the most time considering? What is one simple change you could make to increase your daily exposure to the good and the true and the beautiful that is already there waiting for you to see it? Well, this day, let's end this service doing the very thing we've been talking about, giving thanks to God for all of the good gifts around us. We're going to end by singing a very old hymn, one I really, really love. It's from way back in the day, For the Beauty of the Earth. And as we sing this, those of you who know the hymn may notice that some of the lyrics on the chorus seem a little unfamiliar. That's because we have snuck back into this hymn some of the original lyrics that were written by a 29-year-old in a dark world very much like we're in, when he had a moment of just being overcome by the good gifts of God all around him, back in the year 1864. Thank you.